Okay, first, just want to go over a little bit the mission connection to what we're trying to do here. What we're trying to do is, as we all know, support weather, hydrologic, and climate forecasts and warnings. And in particular, we need to have accurate, precise, timely, and standardized observations, particularly in support of flood operations at the RFC. So a lot of what we do in the observations we take at our local offices are used by the RFCs, and they do consider the observations we take kind of as their gold standard. It's the ones that they look at, and they say, you know, hey, these are the good observations. These are the ones everything else is compared against. So what we do is very important for what they do with their climate modeling. Also, part of our mission is to form a national information database and infrastructure for other agencies, private sector, the public. In particular, the climate observations we take are a critical component of climate data products, and we know how much the media in particular use our information every day. And in particular, the archiving of the data is critical to form our database at NCDC, which is used by a wide range of people for various things, from construction to planning. And also, a lot of this information is used in the climate models and forecasts. So it's all very important what we do with these observations at our WFOs and in general across our entire program of observing. Our general goals, what we're trying to accomplish, is to first fulfill our hydrology and climate requirements, and to do this in a standardized way, make sure that our observing practices are pretty well standardized, our data formats are standard, and also that the way we code and transmit the data is done in a standard way so that we know what the quality control has been on the data. Also, the data is used at NCDC as part of the National Archive, and having good data, and also, as you probably know, in the CSSA database, the metadata is also important to make sure we can trace back where we have different observations. As far as talking about coding, entering, and transmitting observations, WeatherCoder is the supported de facto standard for Central Region, and there's good reasons for actually using this particular program. First, there's extensive quality control assurance algorithms associated with it. Everything's done in standard data formats, and also it's transmitted to NWS systems in real time. And in particular, this is very important from a climate data point of view, is that database is transferred to NCDC, and which is uses it for further quality assurance and then national archiving as part of the database. And it also goes into programs like NOWDATA, XMASIS, which you're probably very familiar with. So that's really important what we do there. In case WeatherCoder goes down, some of the backups you can use in your office is IVROC's phone program, the AWIS program, HydroView, even some people have talked about using RiverPro to make 24-hour totals for the 12Z observation. Also, you can use a local AWIPS or a PC program if that's your preference. Just remember that if for a climate observations, particularly the midnight local standard time, it's important that once WeatherCoder does come back up, that you re-enter that data so it does make it to NCDC, because there's really no other really good way we can do it except going back and doing it through the Datzilla system, which we all know can take some time to get done. It's a it's easier to do it upfront and doing it right the first time around. Local programs, just make sure if you do use them that you know everything's in standard CHEF formats and everything's transmitted properly. And it's your responsibility though for those local programs. We really can't provide support for many of the different programs that may or may not be out there. And just something to think about as we're moving to AWIFS 2 fairly quickly here, it'll probably need to be migrated over, and so you'll have to take that into consideration for continued use of any local programs. Okay, any questions before I just go over the schedule a little bit? Okay, the daily schedule, and this all has been ionized and so forth, and we're looking at basically 6-hourly observations of precipitation, which of course include melted, frozen precipitation, and snowfall, snow depth, and then we have the midnight local standard time, and that one is in particular your climate observation for the day. Also, we have a 12Z snow depth that goes along with the precipitation and snowfall at that time. Also, we are asking for everyone to do a snow water equivalent or snow core at 18Z on Monday. There may be some specials requested, or you're welcome to do it more often as you feel you need to. And but especially during big snow melts, or if we've had a really huge snow, or if we've had a mix of rain and snow, we may ask for specials to be taken. And usually you'll hear that from the RFCs themselves. There's a lot of things you do locally, soil and water temperatures, frost depth, evaporation, and so forth. And that's, you know, that's what you're doing from a local point of view. None of these necessarily that we're saying at this point, you know, are required, but we're everything above there, though, are the things we're asking as the baseline. If you want to do something beyond anything on this list in the top part, you're welcome to do that. That's no problem. And also, to step back just for a moment to explain a little bit more about each of these elements, the 6-hourly and the 24-hour precipitation at 12Z, those are done in support of the hydrology program. The RFCs really count on our 6-hourly precipitation to help them know where to put the the rainfall or the precipitation in their 6-hourly bins in the river models, and those are really important. We are also asking you to do the 12Z 24-hour for them. For the point of view is in case you get busy, and it's easy sometimes to miss this. You know, you've got a squall line coming in. You've got some type of MCS dealing with in the middle of the night. It's easy to miss maybe a 6-hourly observation. And that's just to ensure that they do also get the full 24-hour amount of precipitation that you received at either WFO or at another site. So any questions at this point?
Yeah, hey, John, I got a question. On that 24-hour precip, is that the calendar day from the previous day?
Oh, I'm sorry. You're talking about the 12Z one?
Right.
Oh, yeah. That would be, I'm sorry, that's 12Z to 12Z. So, yes, it would be 12Z from the prior day through 12Z, the current day that you're in.
That's not like a calendar day.
No, that's not the calendar day. The calendar day one will be the 12 a.m. local standard time. Now, that one's used, that's the climate day or the climate observation, actually, the one that's at 12 a.m. local standard time.
Because we do an RTP for that.
Yes, that's true. But I'm glad you brought that up. The RTPs are not used by the RFCs. So that's why it's important anything we do that it does come through WeatherCoder. The RTPs, and it's not necessarily because it's mainly, I think, a lot of times the RTPs come in a little later. Some not. Depends. I know some people do it earlier in the day and so forth. But basically, the RTPs themselves are not used. The RR3s that are sent out, like co-op observations and ASOSs and so forth that may come in, those are decoded by the RFCs, but the RTPs are not.
Is there provisions in WeatherCoder for entering that?
Okay, thank you. That's a very good question. That's the one. saying that we are unable to do with WeatherCoder at the moment. We're going to have to ask everybody to do the 12Z 24-hour if you have another program, or if you just want to use a simple, the AWIPS editor or have a work R3, that would work fine for right now. And if you need to know the exact coding for the chef, just let me know and I can provide that. The reason is that this coming year, the plan is to actually allow two 24-hour type of observations for a site, any given station. Now, the reason we ran into this problem was not necessarily because we wanted to do a 24-hour at 12Z as well as the midnight local time, but it was because of the soil temperatures. Many offices, in your office may be one that actually does soil temperatures twice a day. And unfortunately, WeatherCoder only allows one set of soil temperatures a day, and they're going to be changing that program to allow us to, you know, put in two sets of soil temperatures a day. The reason for that is so that we can have all of our WFOs and our sites go paperless by the end of August in 2012. So that's just so you know that will be fixed. It would just be a temporary. We'll have to do the work R3 until they get the WeatherCoder fixed. And that, once they have it fixed to allow us to do the second one, then we'll just switch into WeatherCoder after that. So that'll be the only one that we have to do outside of WeatherCoder at this point.
So WeatherCoder will be one-stop shop then for this?
Pretty much from almost most of this, except for that 112Z and for the second, you know, set of soil temperatures in a day. Unfortunately, we're kind of stuck with that at the moment. But yes, in general, WeatherCoder is nonsense. Like I said, if you have other ways of doing it, the WeatherCoder though is absolutely critical though for the 12 a.m. local standard time. That's the one that to get it to NCDC. That's how they get our data these days for co-op stations and so forth. So that's kind of the important one to do.
Hey John, this is Gary in Green Bay.
Okay, sorry. I heard Gary and there was somebody else? Or?
Oh, Gary in Green Bay.
Right, okay, go ahead, Gary.
The question I have is related to what you're just talking about here. Mm-hmm. You know, my understanding is NCDC does not receive our data on a daily basis. It's collected on a monthly basis, and then they it's bundled. So, you know, using the WeatherCoder 3 right now, which can only accepts one 24-hour observation from a site, whatever else we do enter into WeatherCoder 3 at other times will override whatever the 24-hour observation was. So in other words, it's very possible that WeatherCoder 3 will end up with just, say, the last 6 hourly of the day as the permanent record that gets sent bundled to NCDC.
Oh, okay. I follow what you're saying. There's a couple things we've actually tested to make sure that is not actually the issue. When I do a little more training and set up with everyone, you know, on the technical aspects, I'll show the way to do this. Actually, doing the 6 hourlies does not overwrite your midnight local standard time. And that data, actually, just so you know, that the daily data that goes into WeatherCoder is processed daily during the night by NCDC. So they don't wait till the end of the month. It's processed in, well, pretty much near real time, actually. So it's not at the end of the month. Now, if you waited to the end of the month to enter everything in the WeatherCoder, that would work too. I mean, they just go in and they pull everything that's new. So whether it's, you know, the current day that you just put in previous midnight, or it's, you know, the 2 weeks ago some information that you put in, then it does pull that if it's new. You know, if it's been changed or corrected or something like that. So yeah, the 6 hourly, that won't affect your 24-hour observation that goes into the quote-unquote B91, online B91 that's on the system. That holds that. So you're actually okay there. None of the 6 hourlies will affect that. We've tested it at several sites, actually. Yes, go ahead.
With the schedule that's in front of us, that will, if we follow that, that will also force us to do two things. One, make updates in our TSSA B44.
Yes, in some places you might need to do that. Yes, that's true.
Also, the A1, A3s in.
Right, you would have to do that. It depends on which type of station we're talking about here. But yes, in the A1s, A3s, also in the B44s, and I'm not going to show you that necessarily, but there are actual specific remarks we're asking people to put in the remarks section so we know what the different sites are being used for, whether it's a SNOPAID or it's a ASOS or whether it's a WFO or another co-op, you know, that's out there that's being used to help create a climate product for any given station, whether it's a ASOS LCD or an ASOS non-LCD. You can create a climate product if you choose, if there's a proper pill in your system already. Or we can actually do a request for change and get that started for you, which we're starting to do for some offices already.
John, if the RTP is already chef encoded, why are we doing the same thing twice at 12Z, putting it into the RTP and a co-op observation?
Well, I can't truly answer that. I know there's some history of why the RTP was done that way, and I don't know what that history necessarily is. All I know is from the RFC point of view, they are not decoding the RTP. So I do know is a fact, actually.
Well, it seems to me it would be easier to turn on the ingest of the RTP at the RFCs than to ask somebody to rewrite a program to accept it to accept that observation and doing the same thing twice.
No, and I understand that, and I believe the RTP now really serves a different purpose than it probably did originally. It does sound like duplicated work. In truth, I'm not sure if it really. I mean, if you send in your weather coder, your River Pro should pick up the RTP. That it'll pick it up and just put it in automatically. So you're not going to necessarily have to enter it twice. It's just if you get it in WeatherCoder ahead of, you know, at 12Z, it should pick up that information when you actually send it out, when you actually create the RTP using River Pro. So you really won't, you'll enter it just once. You shouldn't have to enter it twice. You shouldn't have to.
Well, you'll enter it once into River Pro and then once into WeatherCoder.
Well, no. All you have to do is enter just in WeatherCoder once, because everything you enter in the WeatherCoder goes out as an RR3 in Chef format, and the River Pro should be set up this way. But maybe it's not. I don't know. Everybody does it a little bit differently. Is they should be able to decode that RR3 for, you know, for example, your WFO, and put that in the RTP that goes out at 12Z, or whatever time, it's probably not right at 12Z, but shortly thereafter. So it should be able to do that. You shouldn't have to enter it twice. If you need more help with that, I mean, you know, we can go over that some more too, but you shouldn't have to worry about that. Once it is an RR3 through WeatherCoder, River Pro should be able to pick up that RR3 decoded and put it in the RTP for you.
Yeah, John, is that all RFCs? Because I believe the Southern and Western use the RTPs.
Well, I know that our RFCs, North Central and Missouri Basin, do not.
Okay.
Hey, John, is this a national change or is this just a central region change?
This is just a central region change for right now. They're looking at changing all of this. Part of what drove this was we kept pushing. Finally, they're dropping at our request, actually, and they're dropping the SCD and getting rid of it. And they were pretty close to that, but now they were waiting for us to do this. And as soon as we gave them a date, which would be, you know, which we'll show in a minute, January 31st, actually that product will disappear, and then this is what will basically take its place.
Is the SCD, I mean, the SCD is disappearing nationally?
Yes, it should be, yes. Now, how they're going to do that in other regions, I don't know yet. That's because others, I've been sharing this plan with them, but as far as I know, they haven't developed a similar plan to what we're doing here. So,
okay, is this all, I mean, I know you've mentioned the Missouri and North Central RFC.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Has this been coordinated with the other RFCs that serve the Central Region offices?
We have sent it out to a pretty wide audience. As far as we can tell, we're at this point in time, we're not really taking anything away. I mean, we're still providing the information that they have been getting with the SCD. We're just doing it in RR3, but we have been sharing it, so the knowledge should be fairly widespread by now. If they haven't gotten it, then we'll have to find out why. For whatever reason, they may not have gotten it. But we've also talked with Weather Service Headquarters. They're well aware of what we're actually doing, and they're fine with it. Actually, they were waiting for us to do this so they could call an end to the SCD, actually.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, sure. Well, as far as the timeline for implementation, right now, these are just some the recommended dates to get things by. The long and short of it is, by the end of January, we'd like to, at 12Z, that'd be the last SCD observation, and then start at 18Z with the new observation procedures that we were just talking about. Along the way here, there's like to get make sure the WFO co-ops are established. Any ASOS LCD sites, and then most places already have the LCDs in the co-op program already, so that should not be a problem. The snow-paid sites, just to ensure that so we can put it through WeatherCoder, we need to just have an NWSLI or a CHEF identifier for that. Some offices, if they choose, you want to make it a co-op, that's fine too. Along the way, make sure as we make these changes, then the A1 was mentioned before. The A1, A3s need to be updated for each of the ASOSes that are associated with a snow paid. So basically, by that time, getting all the sites set up around the January 18th, and try to have that pretty much wrapped up. And then a few days later in the process, and we'll be having some training on this, and I'll be providing direct support, set up backup procedures, try to have that done, and start doing some operational testing with the SCD. I mean, just send a WeatherCoder observation out with the SCD, still do them kind of side by side for a couple of days just to make sure everything's functioning properly. What we will have, let me just go ahead just for a second here. We will have an actual, I'll let that catch up with you maybe here. There will be a Google form I'll send out shortly that will have questions for you to answer. Just make sure it's like a checklist sort of thing, that we've got all our bases covered. As soon as you're ready to go, and it looks like everything's fine, just let me know. I'll take a look at, make sure we got everything done, and pretty much at that point, if you've got everything completed, it's pretty much your call when you want to start, just as long as it's no later than January 31st. Okay, before I go past the timeline, any questions on the timeline? Okay, I think a lot of offices have done really a great job. They've got most of this, a lot of this probably accomplished already. ASOSes, just a couple of items on that. Most of them are probably in CSSA already. Anything to do with snow pades and so forth and anything to do with the changes here, yes, make sure the A1, A3 forms are up to date. Of course, the ASOS remains the official LCD location. Though you are welcome to have non-LCD locations, other ASOSes, if you want to do other climate products. If there's also a pill out there, if you need one, I'll do a request for change for you. So that's totally that's your local. We're only requiring that the LCDs are taken care of. Also, we double checked on this. There is no FAA or NWS operational requirement for the WFO to provide data to supplement or back up an ASOS observation. So we just have to be careful that if we measure something at the WFO, that we're not calling over to either contract weather observer or somebody at FAA to, and they put it into the METAR. That's the important thing, that we don't have our data that's not actually that's being measured by one of their folks. We don't want to make sure, we don't want any information that we're doing as a backup or a snow pate actually being added into the actual METAR itself. Now, of course, it can be used for the climate products and the climate program, and of course it'll go out in Weather Coder, but we just have to be careful about that we don't mix the data here. And there's a lot of different reasons for that. Snow pades, just make sure you have a NWS LI or a CHEF identifier, and if anybody needs any assistance with that, let us know. It should not be hard. I know the service hydrologists do it practically almost every day sometimes, it seems like. And also update your ASOS A1, A3 forms at the same time. And then we can set up with just, even with the NWS LI, we can set up the observation in Weather Coder. And of course, then we can also, you can put it into your AWIFS climate program like you've already been doing. So that part really is not going to change a whole lot. Okay, training and support. We'll have training. I'm going to schedule some more webinars. I'm always here, phone, email. Plus, I can do on-the-spot go-to meeting to insist in your setup or training. I did one yesterday, excuse me, with Bill Nelson to show him something. So I can actually, you can see my screen or you can share your screen and show me what you're doing. And if you need help, I can, help you right then and there if you need it. I'm going to be here. Matter of fact, I'll be here pretty much through the whole holidays. So the only day I'm taking off is the 26th, of course. And but outside of that, though, I'll be around, and of course, we'll be definitely around through all of January as we set this up. So if you need anything, or you feel like, gosh, this is the day. It looks like I've got the time to work on this. If you want to set up a time with me to actually work on any of this, then that's fine too. I can put that on my calendar and we can actually work together online on that. So through a go-to meeting. So just let me know. Just let me know what you're going to need. Primary contacts, anything to do with policy, Weather Coder, or training in general. You can contact me, Dan Bloom, with BCSSA for the B-44s, B-43s. Anything with, excuse me, ASOS or the snow pades, well, of course, it'll be Tom Townsend, and that'll be through the end of this month. And after that, well, Tom's retiring, so you'll have to just go ahead and get in contact with myself. By February, during February, Brian Hirsch will then be here to take over that position. Okay, just going to open it up to general questions and answers. If you have anybody, or if even you want to see it, I'll be glad to stay on after this call to answer the real technical, how do I set it up sort of things, or how does it work with Weather Coder. I'll bring Weather Coder up and we can actually work on that and show a couple things if you like. So especially for any of your Opals or Daphnes that may be with you too. So I'll open it up to the floor.
Yeah, John, going back to the A1, A3s,
yep.
What would be the reason to update that other than the snow-pate observer?
Not really much would have to probably be updated. I would just take a look at it because this year it got brought back a little bit, and it may be just fine. I mean, your A1, A3 might be just fine, so... If you kept them up to date, then they probably are in good shape. There probably won't be any real change you'll necessarily have to make on them. that I can think of at the moment. Doesn't mean there's not, but there might be some that I'm just not thinking of right at the moment. But I'll let you know if there is something else that needs to be done. Otherwise, no, probably not. It was more of just a reminder in case you needed to change anything.
Up a bit.
Yeah. Actually, we do have for the AE1A3s, Randy Breezer's been working with us and with Weather Service Headquarters, and he'll have a database program that'll probably be coming out, I'm hoping, early next year, that will be able to capture a lot of this information in a database that's fairly easy to use. Because in about, I'd say about a year or so, I'd say January or so, 2013, we'll probably see the first draft or the first version, I guess I could say, of the new CSSA program, which will be radically different than what we're using right now. And so that's the plan at the moment. Hopefully we'll be able to get away from this older CSSA program. It's just it's the bane of all of us at the moment, to say the least. So any other thoughts, questions, comments?
John, is this presentation going to be available for people to look at somewhere?
Yes, I can. I can put it out there. I'll just put it on the webinars directory on the MetDat server. So yeah, I can send that out. Yep.
Hey John, I got a question for you.
Okay.
You mentioned working with Bill in Chicago.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if the program, did you guys do any of the review of the program that they currently use to send out the RR2s? Because I got to tell you, for our application, that thing's pretty appetizing to use for snowpades or whatnot. It seems like it would really fit the bill for us well up here. Did you look into that, and are you cool with that? Or
no, and I've talked with Bill a little bit about it. If you guys want to use that, that's perfectly fine if you wish to do that. That's completely your call. I know that if he's sending it out as an RR2, I know if we're trying to track something down, typically we're going to be looking for RR3. Not that it matters from a RFC point of view, from a decode point of view, but he would just have to remind me what he's doing if he called and say, hey, we're trying to track something down. But but really the critical part is, if that program's working for you, fine. One thing I did bring up to him was, making sure we migrated over to AWIFS 2, and that's a question mark right there, whether that's, how easy or not that'll be. It might not be hard to do. I don't know. I mean, I just don't know the technical details of the program. But no, if he wishes to use that, and the RFCs are getting the data, it's just for the climate data that we really need to make sure to use the weather coder. For the actual midnight local standard time.
Okay.
That's the important part there. But yeah. Oh yeah. I had spoken with him about that.
Okay. So let me throw one more caveat at that then.
Okay.
If we're we're a co-op that is not, or obviously a co-op at a WFO that is not near the ASOS. Okay.
Right.
So we're going to maintain the 7 a.m. to 7 a.m. co-op ob as we have for the last decade. Then are you fine with us doing Weather Coder 3 as we have for our regular 12Z co-op op and then using that program to send out the additional 6-hourly stuff in lieu of the SCDs?
Oh, okay. Just to let you know, is all the everybody will be going to a midnight local standard time co-op observation. So if you're doing it at 7 a.m. now, it'll be moved back to midnight. Just so you're aware of that. That may not...
Okay.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's I thought early on we decided that if we've been doing the 7 a.m. ones, the 7 a.m. co-op ob, and we're not located near the ASOS, that we would maintain that.
There was talk of that earlier, and we talked about it, but then when it went to INI, between NWS and WECO, that's where things changed. That the idea was, is okay, let's standardize at midnight local standard time. And so that's what became the standard then.
Okay.
So, yeah, that, and I know that'll be a little bit of a change. From a climate point of view, actually, that works out a little better overall, especially as we go in the into the future, that as we do this, we'll definitely be able to have a full set of normals for each WFO, actually, over time. So that'll be, I think, a great part of the database there.
Okay, so on your B44 for mm-hmm. The co-op site, official ops time is going to change to midnight local standard time, and then the 12Z one we send out is going to be a special?
Yeah, the 12Z one, they'll just go out as an RR3, and for the moment, that will be just simply a, the only requirement we have at 12Z would be snowfall, precipitation, snowfall, snow depth, and for the moment, unfortunately, Weather Coder won't handle a second 24-hour observation. And the 12Z to 12Z, so that will have to just be done temporarily until Weather Coder's fixed. Go out as just a, it can go out as an RR3, it can go out through your RR2 program, for example, if you choose. But it'll go in, you can just use the AWIPS editor, do a work RR3, and just send it out that way.
Okay.
And that's just a temporary until we get Weather Coder fixed to allow the second one. Okay. If anybody like any demonstration of things or see how things are done, I'd be glad to do that. Otherwise, I appreciate your attention and great comments and questions. And if you have any more, well, we'll have another one of these on January 5th, or of course, I'm as close as a call or an email.
Okay. Thanks, John.
Thank you. Take care now. Happy holidays.